Welcome to the teaching ministry of Reverend Daryl Baker, pastor of Christian Faith Fellowship. Pastor Baker is fulfilling the call of God on his life to preach the Word of God without compromise, raising up disciples who, through faith in God, will have a powerful impact on our world. May you be blessed through the message that Pastor Baker has to share with you today. May God's very best be yours.
Revelation chapter 2 is where we're going to start tonight. I want to just touch on one little thing real quick, as we just started this series last week. We actually got through Revelation chapter 1, started in Revelation chapter 2. We will move a little quicker through this study after we get through these seven churches that we're going to talk about. But this is vital to our day. This is very important and key to our day, obviously, that we're living in. But I wanted to go back, first of all, real quick, and just quote to you Revelation 1:1, because, you know, the book of Revelation, you know, for years, you know, for most Christians, has been an area that seems to be taboo, and, boy, I don't want to read that because you can't understand it. It's too hard to figure out. But, you know, like Dr. Sutton used to teach, you know, it's a very important book for us to understand, to learn, and glean from, and one that the Bible very clearly tells us we should know about, and the Holy Spirit will help us understand it. And when you got people like Dr. Hilton Sutton, who studied it for over 40 plus years, you know, I guarantee you what, that certainly helps. 60 plus years, excuse me. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And I guarantee you, he brought great insight into this book of understanding the power behind it. But when most people think of the book of Revelation, they're just thinking it's a book about end times. Well, it does refer to the end times. But if you think that the whole focus of the book of Revelation is end times, you're actually missing the primary purpose of the book of Revelation. Revelation 1:1 tells us the primary purpose of this book, the revelation of Jesus Christ. The first five words define for you what we're supposed to be getting out of the book of Revelation. We're supposed to be getting greater revelation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There are 55 direct references, 55 direct references in 21 chapters of the book of Revelation to Jesus Christ. And then there's all kinds of pictures of him in the book. And in the first chapter, it actually gives a description of him as well. I want to go to verse 3, though, because it says in verse 3, "Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near." So literally we're told that if you get into this word, the book of Revelation, read these words of this, the words of this prophecy, keep, listen to that statement, you're to read this book, Revelation, and keep what it says. Do what it says. If you do, you'll be blessed, praise God. Amen. So how many are ready for that blessing? So we're not just reading it to say, okay, so now we understand the end times. No, there's stuff in here we're told to do. There's things that are being revealed to us in this book that you and I need to know that we're to walk out. Amen? Last thing I want to point out that we touched on last week in chapter 1, and that's in verse 19, which literally now breaks down the book of Revelation into three separate parts. It literally helps us understand how this book is totally broken down for me and you to gain insight and understanding to the book of Revelation. I want you to read verse 19 there with me. Revelation 1:19. "Write the things," John was told, "write the things which you have seen, the things which are, and the things which will take place." Now see, that is how he breaks down literally the book of Revelation. He breaks it down into three separate categories. One, what you're reading here is what he had seen, chapter 1. Two, he is writing down the things which are currently in relationship to us, the church age. And then three, the things that will take place after this. So that is how the book of Revelation is broken down. Three separate categories, and we're studying those. We've already covered chapter 1. We wrote down what he saw. Now we're into chapter 2. Now we're writing down basically what applies to us, the church age. Even though the references to seven churches of John's day, it is a prophetic picture. of what we see of the condition of the church as a whole today, broken down in seven different churches. And it's very important for us to understand this, because we need to understand and glean from these letters written to these churches, given to John. We need to glean from these letters what they were doing right, what they were doing wrong, what they were told to correct it. So that's very important for us. Again, remember, if we see what this book says, listen to it, hear it, and do what it says, we're going to be blessed in doing so. Amen. Revelation 2, let's pick it up here in verse 1 as we began to talk about this first church of the seven, this church at Ephesus. All right. He says, to the angel of the church in Ephesus, write, these things says he, talking about Jesus, who holds the seven stars in his right hand. Remember, those seven stars are angels. Angels that were assigned to the churches, messengers. He who holds these seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. The lampstands represented the seven churches. Remember, we talked about this a little bit last week. Jesus, hallelujah, is still walking in the midst of his churches today. Praise God. Verse 2, I know your works. I know your works. First five words out of the Lord's mouth to the church at Ephesus is the same to every single one of the seven churches. The very first thing Jesus says in those letters to be read in those seven churches is, I know your works. Guess what? He knows our works today. No, we don't work our way to heaven. When we get born again, we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. So verse 2, I know your works, your labor, talking to the church in Ephesus. I know your labor. I know your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they're apostles and are not, and have found them liars. Basically, in other words, you have recognized false preachers who claim that they're speaking on behalf of me, but they're not, and you have recognized them as liars. Verse 3, you have persevered, have patience, have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. These are all good commendations of things they did right. Remember, we already went over this in the study of the same elements you see in every one of these letters. There's the commendation to the church. But notice what he comes now to bring a conviction about something that needs to change. Verse 4, nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Now, as we start into these churches a little deeper tonight, because we barely started touching on this church last week, I want you to stop and think about this. I don't want you to automatically assume, because I don't when I read scripture like this, don't just assume that's not a problem for me. Now, don't just automatically think it is in your mind. No, but be open and honest with your heart. Listen to your heart. Listen to the Holy Spirit speaking to you, and actually be honest enough to open up to Him to say, is that me? Because if it is, I want to get it corrected. Praise God. Verse 4, nevertheless, I have this against you. You have left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Can I touch on something here for just a minute? Man, I got so much brewing in me right now to share. We're hearing popular preachers of the day who will tell you that if you're born again, you do not have to repent. Now listen to me. There is a truth in Scripture revealed to us by Jesus Christ in Matthew 24, that in the last days, I want to keep saying this, I don't want to bore you with this, but it's powerful. This is what just keeps stirring in my spirit when I get into teaching this stuff. That in the last days, there will be many, many, many false prophets. Those who claim to speak on behalf of Jesus, but yet what they're saying is not true. False prophets is not those who necessarily, quote unquote, run around prophesying to people. The term prophets there are those who claim to speak God's word, speak on behalf of God. Why are you talking about that? I'm going to tell you why. Because he said in Matthew 24, in the last days, there wouldn't be a few of them, there would be many. Here's my point I want to make. I want to get across two points to you. I want to, out of one of them, out of verse 5. First of all, recognize this. Are we in the last days or not? Are we in the last of the last days or not? If you really believe we are, then we have to make sure, child of God, we've got to make sure that we are shaking ourselves and listening with our hearts to what these scriptures talk about of the picture of the last days, because it's not coming one day. It is here. And if these false prophets are here, and they are, we got to recognize who are they? Who are they? Because I promise you this, if you don't recognize them, and again, this is what Scripture teaches us to do, if you don't recognize them and label them, how easy it is. I'm seeing it. I'm seeing this week after week after week of other believers and people I hear about and people I know. I'm watching people being drawn into error. I'm watching them be pulled into these false teachings by these false prophets. Jesus did not say there would be a few false prophets. He said there would be many false prophets. Matthew 24, and he went on to say, and they will deceive many. I'm not happy about that. I'm not liking that. I'm not wanting to see that. But you know what? That's exactly what Jesus said we would see, and we are seeing it. And I am telling you that there are famous high-level ministers who are saying they are preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. But I tell you, child of God, they are preaching a different gospel, as 1 Corinthians 6 says. Not the one that Paul preached, because they are saying if you're born again, you don't have to repent. Jesus Christ of Nazareth, in a letter given to the Apostle John, told him to take this letter and bring this letter to the church at Ephesus. And the church at Ephesus, believers who have left their first love, need to repent. See, please don't fall prey to these false preachers of the day, these false prophets of the day who are out of line with Scripture. We're going to talk about some things significant to that tonight of how to protect yourself. But every time we touch on these things, it's so important to recognize they're already here. Now, the only way that they could not be here is if we're not in the last of the last days. Because Jesus said in the last days, you're going to have many false prophets. Repentance is New Testament for the believer today still. Because repentance simply means I have had a change of mind. I have seen with my reasoning understanding I've done wrong. Therefore, it has changed my heart, my focus of what I was chasing after, and it will now change how I act, how I live. That's repentance. If I'm going down the wrong road, please, please do not tell me some famous minister says you don't need to turn and repent from going down the wrong road. That's going to lead to harm. That's going to lead to destruction. God is not about putting anybody into bondage. God is the liberator. Could I get an amen? God is the deliverer. He is the one who brings to us what true salvation is all about. Part of the word salvation means deliverance from what? Sin. Its effect on our life. Doing things that are contrary to Scripture that are only going to hurt your life. God is trying to spare us pain. If Jesus is not your first love, that's going to hurt your life. That's going to hurt your walk with God. That's going to hurt your ability to raise your babies biblically. That's going to hurt you to be able to hear from God, to walk out what God has for your life. That's going to open up the door for Satan to deceive you. That's going to open up the door for Satan to mislead you. That's going to open up the door for Satan to take advantage of your life if Jesus is not your first love. Because, listen, you could have a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, and therefore be actually loving something other than Jesus, as something's more important to you. I know Christians who their kids, they love their kids more than they love the Lord. They love their spouses more than they love the Lord. I know believers that love their businesses more than they love the Lord, or they love their job more than they love the Lord, or their toys, or their will, or their lifestyle. Man, I tell you, it's so important. You got to make sure Jesus is your first love. All right? Verse 6, but this you have, I want you to listen to what he went on to tell them here. This you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. You don't hate the Nicolaitans, you hate the deeds. There are things that the Lord hates. We ought to be careful using the hate word, because we don't need to be saying we hate somebody. We should not, that should never come from our mouth. Never, ever, never. We should hate the things God hates, and we should love the things that God loves. Could I get an amen on that? Praise the Lord. I'll tell you what, He doesn't hate people, but He does hate the deeds that people do that mislead people from Him. And He says here in verse, here in verse 6, you do have this about you that He's grateful for, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Now, if Jesus hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans, and He's commending the church at Ephesus for hating the deeds of the Nicolaitans, guess what you and I should do, child of God? We should hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Not hate the ones who are doing it, but hate the deeds they're doing. All right, verse 7, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. We know He's not talking about our physical ear, as I pointed to. He's talking about us having a heart to hear, us being receptive to the Lord and what He wants to say. How do you have an ear to hear, by the way? How do you have, I won't preach on this entire, this entire first seven verses. How do you have an ear to hear what it is that the Spirit is saying? I'll tell you what, if you are coming to God with a heart to serve and not to be served, you'll have an ear to hear. If your desire is to truly walk out His will and not your will, you'll have an ear to hear. See, having an ear to hear means you have to deal with your heart. You have to deal with the focus of your heart, what you're set on. If your heart is set on doing the will of God, you have an ear to hear what God wants to say to you. Because if your heart's desire is to do His will, guess what? When you do wrong, you're going to hear from Him that you've done wrong, because you have a desire to hear from Him. One of the things the Lord has been dealing with me on more than ever in the past 3 months of my life is He's been dealing with me on over and over and over again through 25 years now of ministry. God's showing me this as a pattern, as a form of observation in my church and in other churches, and what I've gleaned from my pastor and I. Man, we spent almost an hour on the phone last night talking about this. But one of the things God's been showing me, and He just keeps bringing this back to my remembrance, is the words of Jesus that He said to the church when He came. He said, I did not come to be served, but I came to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. Now, the Bible teaches us that if we're a follower of Christ, we take the same actions and the same attitude that Jesus actually lived out. We should start with the same attitude, the same heart attitude, which will lead to the same actions. And what the Lord keeps showing me is that what my pastor, let me just explain it this way. My pastor, Dr. Barclay, I remember the first time hearing him say this about 15 years ago. He began to talk about the significance. He might have been teaching it longer than that. I'm just saying what I started hearing it. About 15 years ago, I heard my pastor say that there are those who come into the church solely for the purpose of what they can get. And there is a gospel being presented to them that fits it perfectly, and it's called the self-help gospel. That we have preachers that are teaching a self-help gospel. That what they're preaching is good news, is it's all about a self-help program for a person who comes to God. But the truth is, that's not the truth of the gospel. The gospel is not come and get. The gospel is come and give. Give your life. Lay your life down, and as you lay your life down, you receive new life. It doesn't start out with you receive new life and then you lay your life down. No, you got to lay your old man down. You got to die. You got to choose to release, to repent, to turn from that old nature and then accept the new life. This is all through Scripture. I call it the James 4 principle. Draw near to God and He will draw near to you. It did not say He will draw near to you and you draw near to Him. Now, He sent His Son first. Jesus came and died for us. Jesus did what was necessary for us to return to the Lord. But for us to receive Him now, for us to partake of what He has for us, it now requires us to actually reach out to Him first. He has, in essence, reached out to all of humanity. But the goal now is we now come and lay our life down. As we do, He draws near to us. We receive new life. And when you come to God with the same heart that Jesus came to this world with, Lord, I have come to serve You. I have come to give my life as a ransom to You. Guess what? You have an ear to hear from God. You have a heart to walk out what is God's desire for you. And if you do drift away and the Lord is no longer your first love, you'll get it corrected. You'll fix it. I promise you, you will. Because your heart's desire is to truly chase after Him. Your heart's desire is not to come and get from God. One time, there's many ways God's illustrated this to me. But as an example, the Bible tells us very clearly in the Old Testament not to seek His hands, but to seek His face. Literally, the psalmist David said, Lord, when You said, seek Your face, my heart said, Your face I will seek. Now, that's the same thing as saying, I come to serve, not to be served. See, because the attitude of, I've come to get from God everything He can give me, you're looking at His hands. It's not about relationship to you. I have not lost my point. I'm talking about not losing Jesus as your first love. And if you have, it's because you went from looking to His face to looking to His hands. I'm preaching pretty good right now. You've gone from the heart's desire of serving Him to now Him serving you and what can I get from God. And when you do that, what you've done is you've now made Christianity a religion. You have now made what you do a works to get something instead of walking in relationship with God and knowing He'll add unto me all the things that He's promised in the Word of God. It's a kingdom principle. Seek first the kingdom, and all those things will be added unto you. People that are not tithers or don't give to the work of God either lack understanding that it is biblical and it's right and it's all through the Bible, or they're still dealing with some form of fear about doing so, or they have not come with a heart to serve God. Where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. So there are multiple reasons why one would not sow into the gospel, but one of those reasons would be that their heart is not set on Him. See, this is what would cause a believer. So let's back up for a minute. They left their first love. All right. So their heart was right when they first came. They didn't come to be served. They came to serve. They didn't come seeking His hands. They came seeking His face. You couldn't have left your first love if Jesus wasn't initially your first love. So the whole reason of why you come to God is relationship. You come to get to know Him, to seek His face. In the midst of that, the church at Ephesus, all of a sudden, they began to drift away from making the relationship the priority, and now they began to look at His hands and what He could do for them and the works they were doing instead of the one they were doing it for. Hope you get that point. Because the key here in the aspect of what was going on in the church at Ephesus, the key is making sure that we keep Jesus as our first love. Now, what are some key signs that Jesus is no longer our first love? Well, some of the key signs that Jesus is no longer your first love is that you all of a sudden stop witnessing. The joy of the Lord is not obviously a part of your daily life. It's not your strength anymore. Because the joy of the Lord is what rises up in a believer as they spend time in the presence of the Lord. In His presence, there is fullness of joy. Now, I don't mean every day you're just shouting, screaming, hollering, running around with joy coming out you. I just mean there's a continual joy bubbling up inside of you. See, these are things that begin to go by the wayside if Jesus is no longer our first love. You can't make Christianity, the works of Christianity, what your walk of God is all about. Nope, it's about your relationship with God. Wait a minute. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. And see, this is a problem we got going on in churches today and false teaching and false error. People are actually now, ministers and even believers, diminishing the Word, putting the Word of God down, making light of the Word over relationship with God. Now, wait a minute. This is part of how we develop our relationship with God. But we got to maintain a balance. We don't want to make the Word of God our God in the essence that we're not learning about Him. not just getting a bunch of understanding of principles and etc. There are principles in the Bible. We need to learn them, but it's all about relationship with Him. Here's a better way to put it in relationship to Scripture, and that's what we see in Luke 10, 41 and 42. In Luke 10, 41 and 42, we have the story about Martha and Mary. Remember, Martha got distracted with much serving. Jesus is sitting right there in their home, and He's actually given them opportunity to sit at His feet and fellowship with Him. And Mary, the Bible says, chose the part that was the better part, and that was to fellowship with the Lord, to spend some time in His presence. Martha got distracted with much serving. So here's a perfect example of what it means to lose Jesus as your first love. Is it wrong to serve? Nope. Mary served. She was a faithful servant of God. But I'll tell you what, you got to still have time that you sit at the feet of Jesus. You got to still have time. Notice the setting. It was in their home. You need to have that private time that you are still sitting at the feet of Jesus Christ and spending time fellowshipping with Him through the Word, prayer, etc., getting to know the Lord. So what's important here is when you come to church, do you still serve? Do you still do those things? Absolutely. And you do it for the right reason, because I love God and because I want to help others to get to know Him. And obviously, I get to know Him in serving as well. But in your personal life, child of God, don't drift away from your personal time with Jesus. Don't drift away from sitting at the feet of Jesus. Don't be a Sunday-only Christian. Somebody who only ever talks about or talks to the Lord at church, but Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, you never open the book, you never take time to fellowship with Him through the Word. I love Smith Wigglesworth's quote about the Bible, and this is why I emphasize the Word is vital to building your relationship with God. Smith Wigglesworth said, I'm going to be pretty close to his quote here, I cannot come to know God through my feelings. I cannot come to know God through my experiences. I cannot come to know God through others. I come to know God through His Word. And Smith Wigglesworth knew the Lord. I guarantee you he did. So don't go off to the other deep end here of the ditch that the modern day preachers are diminishing the Bible, and it's not important to read the Word, and you don't have to do all that stuff and don't have to get into all. Listen, you get to know the Lord through the Word of God. I tell my church family all the time, when you open this book, act as if Jesus is sitting right there with you, and you're going to actually hear from Him and fellowship with Him. Talk to Him about it. As you go through verses you don't understand, ask Him to help you get understanding, because again, He's revealing more of Himself to you. So don't diminish the Bible as a part of your relationship with God. I'm going to quote Smith Wigglesworth, from now till the rapture occurs, or I go to be with the Lord. And my Bible says, imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. The people who diminish the Bible and say they know God, it's amazing when you start hearing them talk about what they hear God say, it don't line up with the book. Because again, you don't get to know God apart from His Word. He and His Word are one. But it's important to understand that we got to have this personal time of devotion and fellowship to God to keep developing that relationship with Him. Could I get an amen on that? Praise the Lord. All right, in your syllabus, before I just totally run out of time tonight preaching on this, in your syllabus, I told you page 25, I'm going to go back to page 23. Sorry about that. I was going to talk about the Nicolaitans for a minute, but I'm going to put that off for just a second. Since we're talking about the importance here, first of all, of dealing with Jesus being your first love, go back to page 23 on your syllabus for just a moment. If you're in the older version, we're under point 2 of highlights of churches in chapter 2. Highlights of churches in chapter 2. And we're talking here about the church at Ephesus, which means first love. Again, this church leaves its first love for Jesus. Jesus walks in the midst of the candlesticks. He's still in the midst of churches today. Thank God for it. He commends them on many things, but the conviction again was that they had left their first love. In verse 4, the believer's first love has to be for Jesus. It is an agape love, obviously, that is the God kind of love, but it had been replaced by human works. So you got to realize that human works in the church isn't bad. Serving God's not bad, but we can't have that replace our relationship with Jesus Christ, that you're never like Mary taking time in your personal life to sit at the feet of Jesus. You must do this. So obviously, if you're not taking time to continually spend time in your personal walk with the Lord, to sit at His feet, you need to go back to doing so. I can remember. Remember what He tells them? Repent and do the first works. Oh man, I remember right after I got born again, boy, I'll tell you what, I didn't just find a church. My nights changed. Instead of sitting there watching TV every night, I went and bought a Bible. I began to get in the Word. I began to read Scripture. I began to spend time studying the Word. But you know what can happen over time? You can leave your first love. All of a sudden, you can drift away from what you were initially doing when you first got born again, because man, that love, that fervency, that zeal for God was so alive in you when you first got born again, that if you were like me, boy, I tell you, you were pursuing getting in Bible studies, you know, in your church, and an opportunity to fellowship with those believers and spend time personally in the Word and pray and seek God. Man, I was doing all of that. But before long, if you're not careful, you can drift away from that personal time with God. And like Martha, you can get distracted by many things. And before you know it, that personal time with Jesus is gone. So let's make this clear again. All right, what is the key that He's dealing with the church at Ephesus about that needs to be fixed? It is not wrong. He's commending them. He commends them for all of the works they were doing in their service for Christ. But you can't drift away from being like Mary and sitting at the feet of Jesus on a regular basis throughout the week and spending personal time with the Lord. Child of God, if that's you, you've got to correct that. Because I promise you this, if you don't do that, you're open to be misled and deceived and taken advantage of by the enemy. Jesus must be your first love. Could I get an amen on that? Praise God. Now turn back over to page 25 in your syllabus. I want to touch real quick, because this will be very important for us as we go through the other seven churches moving forward in the weeks ahead. We're going to touch on at least one more tonight. This will be very important for us. I'm not belaboring these points, you know, by accident. I'm doing this on purpose. I am setting us up for what is so vital for what we're going to go through. Because when we start going through these other churches, we'll go through them pretty quick. We won't take as much time. But it's important to understand some key points here that will apply to every single one of these churches that we're talking about. Because we need to be looking at us, and we need to be recognizing, is that me? That's the purpose of these letters. They weren't just written for the churches of their day. This is what is for us today, right here, right now, to make sure that that obviously is not us. And if so, we're going to get it fixed immediately in Jesus' name. Could I get an amen on that? Praise God. You know, the Holy Spirit just keeps dealing with me on this. So I want to take a moment and obey Him. I want you to take a moment right now, everybody, just streaming with us. I know, even if you're at home by yourself, nobody's looking. But you know, it helps to close your eyes to listen to your heart so you're not getting distracted by other things. Take a moment. Close your eyes right there where you're at. Even if you're around some other people or just sitting by yourself or watching on your phone, I want you to take a moment and listen to what I'm asking you to do. I want you to ask yourself, talking about the spirit man on the inside, ask your heart, Lord, have I drifted from You being my first love? Am I not as fervent as I used to be about spending quality time with You and sitting at Your feet like Mary, and just getting in Your presence and enjoying Your presence as I would open the Bible each day and spend time with You? Have I drifted from that? I'll tell you what, I want you to listen carefully to your heart. Keep your eyes closed. If the Lord's nudging you on this right now, and especially if you're around other people, you know, this is between you and the Lord, I just want you to receive this prayer of mine. And I want you to just kind of repeat it in your heart. Now, if you're by yourself, you can say it out loud. I want to pray for you, first of all. Heavenly Father, I want You to show anybody that's streaming right now with us by internet, or anybody that's going to listen to this video or teaching later by audio, that if we right now know, as we've examined our heart, that we've left our first love, that we are not spending the quality time that we should with You, building relationship with You like we should, that what this is all about, that we need to truly correct this in our life right now. We need to get it fixed. We need to go back and do the first works. We need to go back and get a hunger for the Word of God again, immerse ourselves in the Bible again, immerse ourselves in personal time of prayer again. As Ephesians chapter 4, I believe, says, we need to redeem our time. Buy back the time that we've allowed to be taken from us, that we're doing all other kinds of things with our life, that have no eternal value, and we're not building relationship with you. Now, for anybody that you're touching the heart of, I'm just going to agree with them right now in prayer as they're praying from their own heart that in the name of Jesus, they're returning to you, Jesus. They're committing right now in their own hearts and their own words. They're committing to you, Jesus, to get this fixed, to go back to do the first works, the first works. Go back and do the first works. Go back and make the Word a priority in your life again. Not just on Sunday, but every day. Make prayer a priority again. Talk to God throughout the day. Make many books a priority again to have them in your hand. Keep them with you. Spend time getting to know Jesus. Make fellowship with other believers that are walking in like faith a priority in your life in Jesus' name. We got to go back and do the first works. It's more than just a change of mind. It's a change of actions. And those first works are the things that many false preachers are saying today we don't need to look to like the Bible. But we do. They're wrong. The first works are getting back into the Word with a fervency and a hunger for Jesus again. And doing what Scripture teaches. Opening those Scriptures and letting God speak to us. And we fellowship with Him because He and His Word are one. Thank you for helping every one of us to keep you as our first love. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Sometimes there's no better time like the present as God's moving on people's hearts to get it correct, to get it fixed. I think it's interesting to note, He didn't say to fix this, you just have to pray a prayer. Now, we did. That's a good place to initiate what we just prayed. But you got to go back, verse 5, and do the first works. Works. Get back in the Scriptures every day if you're not, but do it with a fervency for Him. Come on, child of God, start talking to the Lord every day. So easy to get caught up in daily life and not talk to the Lord. Start praying in the Holy Ghost again. Just do those things that will reinitiate your sitting at the feet of Jesus and listening to Him. Amen. So important we do that. All right. Now, I want to show you something again real quick here. Like I said, this will apply as we move forward. In verse 6, He said again, you have this that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans. I touched on five things that were evident in the New Testament times of the deeds of the Nicolaitans. All right. Who were the Nicolaitans? They were followers of one of the very first deacons in the book of Acts, a gentleman by the name, at the time, a disciple of Jesus by the name of Nicholas, who began to pull away from the doctrines of the Apostle Paul, the Apostle Peter, the New Testament disciples. He literally said that what they were teaching was too strict. Oh, ain't nothing new under the sun, child of God. I've heard it all. You're too strict. You're too controlling. They had a very liberal view, Nicholas did, and all of his followers of the Scriptures. But you know what? I wanted to do this tonight. On page 25, I want to read this right to you about the Nicolaitans real quick. And then underneath there, here's a great place in your book to write down the five things I gave you about the deeds of the Nicolaitans. There are five primary things that we find about the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Why is it important for us to understand that? I'm going to tell you why. Because Jesus said that He hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans and commended the church at Ephesus for doing so as well. And you're going to see that this is a part of what's prevalent among the false preachers today. This is a part of what the book of Revelation is all about. It's about revealing Jesus to us. And when you reveal Jesus to us, then we're going to walk in His example. What are we revealing about Jesus here? He hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Therefore, you and I need to know what they are, and we need to hate those deeds as well. Not the people that do them, but the deeds. We need to hate them. I guarantee you, some people don't understand how important this is, because if you don't, then you're open to receive them. You're open to listen to them and to hear them and to be a partaker of these errors. All right, on your book, page 25, down here where it talks about the Nicolaitans, this is Dr. Sutton's notes. Nicolaitans, a party desiring a return to a priesthood. The spirit of the Nicolaitans exists today in church boards, which control the spiritual life of the church. the word laity. Now, if you don't know what the word laity means, that's talking about anybody other than the fivefold ministry. We have the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, fivefold ministry. Everybody else that's not called a fivefold ministry is considered the laity or the lay people of the church. The word laity is embodied in the meaning of the word Nicolaitans. Today, laity, who are not necessarily spiritual, control every facet of some churches, not mine, but it's prevalent in the body of Christ. I'm going to say that again. Today, laity, who are not necessarily spiritual, control every facet of some churches, including the pulpit. Ministers who submit all control to boards and often allow them to determine what will be preached are hirelings and offer no spiritual leadership. The Nicolaitans accepted the teachings of a deacon known as Nicholas, again in the book of Acts. Here's a question that Dr. Sutton poses. How can laymen, now remember, layman is anybody other than an apostle, a prophet, an evangelist, a pastor, a teacher. So who would be the layman? Elders, deacons, and all the rest of the church. All right? How can laymen, who too often cannot ascertain the will of God for their own lives, possibly know the will of God for the church? Great question. Thank you, Dr. Sutton. Powerful question. How can laymen in the church, who too often cannot ascertain the will of God for their own lives, they can't even seem to walk out the will of God for their own lives, how can they possibly know the will of God for the church? How is that possible? Too many churches have a congregational government, which means the people rule. This type of rule is considered democratic. The word democracy means the people rule, which is exactly what the Nicolaitans desired. Notice Jesus said he hated their deeds. He hated their deeds. You know what Jesus just, you know what Hilton Sutton just revealed to us that Jesus hates? Jesus hates not the people. He hates congregational rule style governments. Jesus hates presbytery rule style governments. Presbytery rule, let me back up. Congregational rule. Congregational rule means whoever's a member of the church has a vote, and that means they can vote a pastor in or they can vote a pastor out. He's nothing but a hireling, as Jesus talked about later in actually John 10. Hirelings are not going to be people who are going to bring forth things of the Spirit of God in the way that God wants to, because the minute he says something out of line with obviously the leadership of the church, they can take a vote. If 51% of the members don't want the pastor anymore, they can fire him. And obviously, even though the other 49% may want what he's teaching, doesn't matter. The majority rule. That's a congregational style rule. Not biblical. It was a part of what Nicholas established that was a deed that Jesus hated. Presbytery rule, which again is laymen controlling the pastor. Presbytery rule would be anything from deacons and elders, or any type of leadership in the church or leadership elsewhere outside of the church, Presbytery rule would be any of those within the church of elders or deacons, again, calling the shots, making the decision as to whether a pastor is doing what he should or shouldn't do, and therefore they can hire and fire the pastor. They can correct the pastor. No pastor is to be submitted or in essence, therefore, accountable to the laity of the church. Wait a minute. A pastor must be accountable and must be submitted. To who? A pastor over him. Leadership over his life. A pastor in his life. Not a hierarchy rule of one leader over the entire church worked, because therefore that one leader could not know all the pastors of all the church. Every pastor should have a pastor. Every pastor should have leadership over his life. But when you submit to laymen in the church, that's a deed of the Nicolaitans, which Jesus hated. Because you know what it causes? It causes the pastor to become a hireling. He now has to obviously think about what he's preaching, even if he's preaching in line with the word. If he starts preaching something that the deacons don't like or something that the elders don't like, and they start making that known to the pastor, they have the ability to hire or fire him. That's going to control what a pastor preaches, even if he's preaching in line with the word. Now, what if an elder or leadership in the church believes the pastor is out of line with the word? Guess what? They don't go to the pastor. They go to the pastor's pastor. They tell him, and they got to have some evidence, some proof of what they're saying is true. Our pastor's totally out of line with Scripture. You're his leadership. He needs to be corrected. That's biblical. That's right. But for leadership to say they're the ones to correct the pastor, it's not right. That's a deed of the Nicolaitans. Totally out of line with Scripture. You know how many churches are being ruled this way? Obvious why the enemy would have infiltrated churches to set up their governments this way. This is what causes church splits. We're not talking about a handful of people leaving a church, handful of families. We're talking about a total divide. I've never had that in 25 years. My pastor, Dr. Barclay, has never had that in 25 years. Because you know why? We don't operate under the deeds of the Nicolaitans. We operate under the biblical governments of the New Testament church. So, I want to go over those five deeds of the Nicolaitans. And right here is where you can get them down in your book. So you'll always have them to be able to be referred to, knowing this is a part of what we also need to recognize as we're getting Jesus revealed to us to be our first love in this first church. We're also getting Jesus revealed to us of what he does not like, that he hates the deeds of, and so we need to hate those deeds as well. Number one, the Nicolaitans taught impure doctrines. They taught impure doctrines. Things that the Bible said were obviously wrong, unholy, and should not be done, they taught as acceptable. Number two, they therefore followed those impure doctrines. If you're going to teach impure doctrines, what are you going to do? You're going to follow impure doctrines. I know of ministers, famous, big following, thousands of people that listen to their teachings, who teach things about sexual immorality that is unacceptable in the eyes of God, but say that it's okay to do so. I'm going to tell you what, they are teaching the deeds of the Nicolaitans. I'll tell you why they teach it, because they practice it. You're going to be practicing what you teach. And that's totally, again, a deed of the Nicolaitans. So again, number one, they taught impure doctrines. Number two, they followed impure practices because they taught wrong doctrines. Number three, they believed in a community of wives and sexual sins. Now, this doesn't mean that if somebody doesn't believe in that, they're not following the deeds of the Nicolaitans. These are five different types of deeds the Nicolaitans held of what they believe. But anybody to follow even one or two of these should not be doing so, because it's something that Jesus said he hated. So they believed that it was okay to have multiple wives. They also believed that it was okay to commit sexual sins. Number four, they mixed pagan rites. The Nicolaitans mixed pagan rites with Christian ceremonies. What is mixing pagan rites with Christian ceremonies? The simplest example I could give, I gave you last week, real quick. It is totally out of line with God's will, obviously, for anybody to get drunk. I don't want to deal with the alcohol issue here. I'm just going to deal with a direct aspect of what was part of the deeds of the Nicolaitans. The Bible's clear that we're not to get drunk. All right? Guess what they did? One of the most holy Christian ceremonies in the eyes of God is marriage. And when two people get married at the altars of God or wherever they choose to, with a man of God officiating that ceremony, that is one of the most holy ceremonies in the eyes of God. These are two people that are setting their lives aside and apart to God and to one another to become one in the flesh and one with God. That's a holy ceremony. But then after the ceremony's over, man, you got all this alcohol, people drinking and partying and getting drunk, and they see nothing wrong with it. That is mixing pagan rites with Christian ceremonies. Number five, they wanted the church to be controlled by laymen. We just read it. Fifth deed of the Nicolaitans, they wanted the church to be under the control of either the congregational rule or a presbytery rule, deacons or elders. Totally out of line with Scripture. So that's the deeds of the Nicolaitans. Hope you got all that down. Praise God. All right, real quick, I want you to look at one last thing vital to what we're going to look at. Oh man, I hope you're getting this tonight. I'm having a great time teaching this to you. I'll tell you what, because it's so powerful to understand these truths that help free us, not put us in bondage. Could I get an amen on that? Isn't it amazing how we're seeing total fulfillment of what Scripture prophesied, one of which of the prophecies of the last days is that people will claim what was once obviously very known to God as good is now evil, and what is evil is good. Boy, are we hearing that, because now you got people saying what the Bible says is good is evil. Man, it's wrong to have to think you got to still live by the Word and do all these things, etc. They're taking what's good for you and claiming it's evil. Now they're claiming what's evil, oh, you don't have to repent of sin, you're saved by grace, is good. Wrong. Totally wrong. But we're in that day. We're in that day. Because we are, and because we got to be so understanding of something that was said here to this church and to all these churches, I want to go over something with you that's in Dr. Sutton's book that is the companion to the Revelation syllabus. Look at verse 7 of Revelation 2. Hope you're not bored. I'm sure not. Revelation 2, 7. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Now here's another key to this, because I didn't finish the verse. Read it. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So here, what are you overcoming? You're overcoming this being drawn away from Jesus being your first love. But notice the phrase at the start, he who has an ear to hear, let him hear. We got to make sure what we're hearing is of God. Can I get an amen on that, child of God? We got to make sure that what you and I are hearing is something that truly is coming from God. So verse 7 is telling us we got to learn to truly hear from the Spirit of God what God is really saying. All right? Now I want to give you a verse for your notes. Write this down. 1 Corinthians 2:15, because I'm just now coming out of the book of revealing revelation that Dr. Sutton wrote. This is part of his notes in the book that is the companion to the syllabus here. All right? In his notes, Dr. Sutton talks about 1 Corinthians 2:15 in relationship to verse 7 here of Revelation 2:7. Because 1 Corinthians 2:15 says, he who is spiritual judges all things. We're being told again today, don't judge anybody. Well, we're not judging people to condemnation. To do so is wrong. To look at any person based on what they're doing, if they're living sinful, and say you're going to hell is wrong. We can't say that, because we don't know if they'll turn back to God. We don't know if they'll get right with God. No one knows the heart of a man except the man himself. But biblically, 1 Corinthians 2:15 says we can look at what they're doing, and if it doesn't line up with the Bible, we can say what they're doing is wrong. Deeds of the Nicolaitans is another example. See, he didn't hate the Nicolaitans, he hated the deeds they were doing. So it is not unscriptural or wrong. It is totally scriptural and right, and a necessity for you and I as a believer. If you're going to hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches, we have to be able to look to what we're seeing happening around us and judge all things. Not the person, but what's going on, what they're doing, what's being taught. If you don't do that, you're going to miss being able to walk accurately in line with the Holy Spirit. Because Dr. Sutton gives five things I'm about to give you. This may be as far as we get tonight, but it's important to get this down. Five things Dr. Sutton gave us in his book on revealing revelation that are vital, that you and I must know as to how to hear from the Spirit of God what God's saying to us. How can we judge all things biblically to know we're hearing from God accurately? Number one, the Holy Spirit exalts no one but Jesus. I'm gonna give you scripture references for these right out coming right out of Dr. Sutton's book. Number one, how do you judge all things so we know what we're hearing is from God, so we're not falling prey to the error of the deception of the day? We're not getting off into error, all right? One, the Holy Spirit exalts no one but Jesus. So whatever you're hearing in the way of preaching or any things that are being done as signs and miracles and wonders, let me help you. Anytime that is truly of God, Jesus is going to be exalted. Jesus is going to be recognized immediately and glorified for what's being done. Because if the Holy Spirit is doing something, revealing something, or manifesting in some way, He will exalt no one but Jesus. John 15:26. Just write the verse down. We don't have time to look them up. John 15:26 says the Holy Spirit will testify of Jesus. He's not going to testify of Himself. What He does will be a testimony to Jesus Christ. So again, number one, the Holy Spirit will exalt no one but Jesus. So anything that's happening that we see or we hear that's being told to us is of God, if it's not exalting Jesus, it's not of God. Number two, the Holy Spirit always directs attention to Jesus. I'm going to say that again. The Holy Spirit always, always directs attention to Jesus. He does not direct attention to a preacher. He does not direct attention to a ministry. He does not direct attention to Himself. He directs attention to Jesus. Now listen, even the disciples, when they did miracles, what happened? The people initially ran upon them and looked to them. But remember what they said, whoa, 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 why are you looking at us as if we did this? You see, if somebody tries to exalt a person for a miracle that's done, if that work was of God, they will immediately say, hey, I didn't heal him, Jesus did. Let's thank Him. Let's give glory to Him. But if a minister says, oh man, praise God, it's a wonderful thing. Aren't you glad that this brother's healed? Aren't you glad? And they're bringing attention to them or their ministry. Well, you know, I've been praying for hours and believing God for this breakthrough. And thank God this brother got his breakthrough. It ain't because they prayed for hours. It's because Jesus came and manifested and did the work. So the Holy Spirit always directs attention to Jesus. John 16:13-15. John 16:13-15 says the Holy Spirit will also always glorify Jesus. All right? He'll not only testify of Him, He'll bring glory to Him because He draws attention to Jesus. Number three, again, we're talking about five keys for judging all things so that we know, as we're told here in Revelation 2:7, that we're hearing from God. We want to hear from God, but we need to make sure it's Him. You could have a desire to hear from God, but you may not be hearing God. I guarantee you, Satan's going to do everything he can to try to make you think you're hearing from God, to mislead you and lead you off into error. So we need to know we're hearing from Him. Three, the Holy Spirit never violates the Word of God. Oh man, that's a biggie. I'll guarantee it. Brother Hagin, Kenneth Hagin, he emphasized this over and over and over again. The Holy Spirit never violates the Word of God. That's why I always default to the Word of God, because I guarantee you what, God is never going to go against His Word. I cannot tell you how many times I've heard believers tell me that what they're doing, they know is something God told them to do, when you can take them to Scripture and show that they're in violation of God's Word. Man, they'll explain it away. Well, I know the Bible says that, but I know I've heard from God. Listen, the Holy Spirit never violates the Word of God. Never, never, ever, never, 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 ever. And so-called miracles, signs, and wonders that are being claimed to be of God, but you can't find them in the Bible, they don't line up with Scripture, it's real simple. That ain't of God. Satan can also do deceiving, lying signs and wonders, and we're told in the last days he will do so, again, to mislead even the elect. All right? Scripture for this, John chapter 1. Verses 1 and verse 14. John chapter 1, verse 1 and 14. Jesus is the Word. Because the Holy Spirit exalts Jesus and directs attention to Jesus, and He's the Word, the Holy Spirit will never violate the Word of God. Come on, we got to hurry. Number 4, the Holy Spirit does everything unto edification. The Holy Spirit does everything unto edification. 1 Corinthians 14:26. Whatever comes as a manifestation of the Spirit will come for the purpose of edification. All right? Now, I love the way Dr. Sutton defines this, because the Holy Spirit will challenge us. To be edified or built up doesn't mean He won't challenge you. He will challenge you to grow. He will challenge you to change. But in that challenge, He's doing so to build you up. not tear you down. So he's not telling you you're a dirty dog, you're worthless, you're no good. Any such preaching is not of God. That is not true. That's an absolute lie. Any minister that is not telling you you're a child of God, you're born again, you're washed in his blood, that's who you are as a spirit being. But if they start dealing with your flesh, the deeds, the works you're doing, listen, if what they're telling you is out of line with Scripture, they're not judging you, the person, the spirit on the inside. What they're doing is biblical and it's right. They're trying to build you up by challenging you to change the things in the natural that are wrong. That's not unbiblical. They're wrong if they're telling you that you're worthless, you're no good, you'll never amount to anything. Man, you're going to hell. Now see, that's totally aligned with Scripture. That's going completely off in the wrong ditch again, on the opposite side. But the Holy Spirit does things unto edification. That includes challenging us, correcting us, as Scripture teaches. But the purpose, again, is correcting and challenging the deeds, the things we're doing that are out of line. Number five, last one. The work of the Holy Spirit withstands all examination. The work of the Holy Spirit withstands all examination. What do you mean by that? Listen, you can judge anything that's of the Holy Spirit and it will live up to all these four things we just gave you. Which then brings about the answer of the fifth thing. The work of the Holy Spirit will always withstand all examination. 1 Thessalonians 5:21, test all things. Hold fast to that which is good. Anybody who is being challenged by works they're actually performing or things they're preaching that are very clearly proven to be wrong according to Scripture, and they turn around and tell you that you're wrong for challenging them from the Bible, I'll guarantee you what, that ain't of God, because the work of the Holy Spirit will withstand all examination. If what they're doing is of God, it will withstand examination in light of the Scripture. It will line up with the Bible. Could I get an amen on that? Praise God. So it's so important you understand these five things that determine how you and I know how to judge all things biblically. Because if we know how to do so, then guess what? We're not going to be let off into error. And now we'll be able to examine what we're seeing, what we're hearing, and recognize whether or not it's right in light of Scripture. So next week, man, we're going to start going through these other churches, and we will probably get through the rest of them to the end of chapter 4 probably in our next session, because now we'll just start going through each one, pointing out the simple things that needed to be corrected. But boy, it's so important to prepare for that, to understand these key things that we've been talking about tonight and we began to touch on last week. So again, just a real quick reminder of what we've talked about. We need to learn to hate the things that God hates. And we need to be aware of these deeds of the Nicolaitans. They're going to come up again in another one of these churches because Jesus hates them. The deeds, not the people. Number two, as the first church had an issue of leaving their first love, we need to make sure that we're spending that quality personal time with the Lord. Our heart is still set on Him. We're seeking His face, not His hands. We've come to serve Him, not to be served. Many ways you can say that, but He's got to be your first love. And then number three, we need to know how to judge all things according to Scripture so that we can know we're hearing what the Spirit of God is saying.
Pray that you are blessed by the message Pastor Baker shared with you today. For more spiritual resources that can help you in your walk with God, or to invite Pastor Baker as a guest speaker, just go to our website at cffchurch.com. You will find additional teachings by video, audio, and printed resources that will be a blessing to you. May God's very best be yours.